gonna buy a paper doll that I can call my own. A doll that other fellows can achieve. And then the flirty, flirty guys with their flirty, flirty eyes will have to flirt with all this that'll be. When I come home at night, she will be waiting. She'll be the truest doll in all this world. I'd rather have a paper doll to call my own than have a fickle mind of me like this.
I guess you played the doll game over and over. I guess you've had a million dolls or more. You just quarreled with two. That's why you're blue. She's gone away and left you just like all dolls do. I guess you know it's tough to be alone. And it's tough to love a doll that's not your own.
I'm through with the loving. I'll never fall again.
Hey boy, what you gonna do? I'm going to buy a paper doll that I can call my own. A doll that other fellows cannot see. And then the flirty, flirty guys with their flirty, flirty eyes will have to flirt with dollies that'll be. When I come home at night, she will be waiting. She'll be the truest doll in all this world.
I'd rather have a paper doll to call my own
than have a fickle-minded real
expect to get your day's work done. Oh, you never get your day's work done. Sleeping in the noonday sun. Lazy bones, sleeping in the shade. Now tell me, how you expect to get your corn meal made? Oh, you never get your corn meal made. Sleeping in the evening shade. Now when you taters need spraying, I bet you keep praying that the bugs fall off of the vine. And when you go fishing, I bet you keep wishing that the fish won't grab at your line. You such a lazy bones, sleeping all the day, tell me. How you expect to make a dime that way? You'll never make a dime that way. Well, looky here, he never heard a word I said. All the day. Now how you expect to make a dime that way? Or you'll never make a dime that way. Well, looky here, he never heard a word I said. Sleeping all the day, you were good for nothing, lazy bone.
And my puppy are the dearest friend to me. If it hadn't been for Mom and Pa, I don't know where I'd be. Every night I thank my stars that I was born their king. I know that you'll agree with me when I tell you what they did. They made me swing for my supper when I was a tot. They made me rock and roll and put it on red hot. Each night at the table, here's what Papa said. Get it and warm up me hidey high, sling me a slice of bread. Reading and writing, my mama said, won't help to make you quick. So they taught me, brought me up on good old arithmetic. Yeah, right now I'm flying high, I'm gonna reach my goal. Swinging for my supper, they put a rhythm in my soul.
I met a cowboy riding the range one day, and as he jogged along, I heard him singing the most peculiar cowboy song. It was a ditty he learned in the city. Oh, come a tie, come a tie, yip to the eye, get along. Get help, little doggy, get along. You'd better be on your way, get along. Get help, little doggy, then he trucked it on down the old fairway, singing his cow, cow, boogie in the strangest way. Come a tie, come a tie, hip to the eye, singing his cowboy song. He's just too much. He's got a knocked-out western accent with a Harlem touch. He was raised on local weed. He's what you call a swing half-breed, singing his cow-cow boogie in the strangest way. Come a tie, come a tie, hip to sky.
Silhouetted us, and all was
arms crept round me. His soft lips found me. Then I whispered, dear, you got to go. Oh, darling dear, it's getting late. The clock has just struck one. I'll give you another kiss or two if you promise then you'll run. But first, blow out the candle. Blow out the candle. Blow out the candle so the neighbors won't see. Won't you blow out the candle? There will be no scandal, and no one will know you've been kissing me. Darling dear, time goes so fast. I know it's after two. Gee, anyone can see you're a man with a past. My lipstick looks so cute on you, won't you? Blow out the candle, blow out the candle, blow out the candle so the neighbors won't see. Won't you blow out the candle so there will be no scandal and no one will know you've been kissing me. Darling, I feel so helpless. My resistance is gone, I fear. But before we snuff the last candle, tell me once more you love me, dear. So we blew out the candle. Blew out the candle. We blew out the candle so the neighbors couldn't see. Yes, we blew out the candle to avoid a scandal that all at once did we realize that the dawn comes up like thunder and the sun shows.
Who call on young cuties. But now I find I'm more inclined to keep my mind on my duties. Since I began to share in such a sweet love affair. Though I'm in love, I'm not above a date with a duke or a caddy. But that's a pose, 'cause my baby knows that my heart belongs to daddy. When some good scout invites me out to dine on some fine fin and patty, my baby's sure his love is secure, 'cause my heart belongs to daddy. Yes, my heart belongs to daddy, so I simply couldn't be bad. Yes, I'm gonna marry daddy. Da 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 da. So So if you feel romantic, laddie, let me warn you right from the start that my heart belongs to daddy and my daddy belongs to my heart. Belongs to daddy. My baby's sure his love is secure, 'cause my heart belongs to daddy. Yes, my heart belongs to daddy, so I simply couldn't be bad. Yes, I'm gonna marry daddy. Da 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 da. So if you feel belongs to daddy, and my daddy belongs to my heart. But that's suppose, 'cause my baby knows that my heart belongs to daddy. My baby's sure his love is secure, 'cause my heart belongs to daddy. Yes, my heart belongs to daddy, so I simply couldn't be mad. Yes, my heart belongs to daddy. Da 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 da. So if you feel romantic, laddie, let me warn you right from the start that my heart belongs to daddy. And my daddy belongs to my thank you.
I'm Oba Babatunde. Thank you for joining us. Over the next hour, you'll hear the truth about a legend you may have never been introduced to.
Yeah, right now I'm flying high. I'm gonna reach my goal. Swinging my last supper, they put a ribbon in my soul.
Though I'm in love, I'm not above a date with a duke or a caddy. But that's supposed as my baby knows that my heart belongs to daddy. You do something to me that nobody else can do.
Dorothy Dandridge was both goddess and trailblazer, magical and memorable, whether in nightclubs, film, or television. In the 50s, her charisma, talent, and strong will helped her pioneer changes in racial attitudes. Her personal life was overwhelmingly full of torment and tragedy. The road to stardom was paved with more potholes than red carpets, yet Dorothy's talent and beauty would not be denied.
She had the magnificence of an elegant lady with a beautiful soul. She was the epitome of a God-given creature that surpasses the words of us earth-given people. She was magnificent.
This woman is singular because she was the first woman of color in our country, the first black woman, who was able to lead with her sexuality.
She was as gorgeous up close as pictures showed her to be. This was not a case of a photographer having to touch up film to make the personality look as great as publicity claimed they were. She was striking and troubled.
To understand Dorothy Dandridge, I think it's necessary to understand that she came from a dysfunctional home. Her mother was a lesbian, was in a lesbian relationship, and there's certainly evidence that her mother's lover molested or did things that were not appropriate with Dorothy.
I think in her mind, she was a victim, and there were a lot of reasons for her to be a victim, but I think she felt like one. And in interviewing Diane Carroll to do this story years ago, we were in the Four Seasons having breakfast, and Diane said to me, well, first of all, Jasmine, you're being judgmental. You have to remember the time that we were in. For example, we wouldn't have valeted in the front and come through that door, and we wouldn't be sitting here right now. So putting all of that into context for me helped further understand Dorothy.
America was trying to push the dark days of World War I into faint memory when Dorothy Dandridge was born in Cleveland, Ohio on November 9, 1922. Change was in the air. The 20s were starting to roar. The music, laughter, and party were building to a feverish pitch. Women were rebelling. All over the world, flappers of all ages were challenging the old norms. Newly armed with the vote, they wanted freedom in a male-dominated world. Demands were made for their own standards in fashion, politics, and sexual conduct. Born into that racist, sexist world, Dorothy Dandridge rose above its restrictions to become a cultural icon, changing the long-held and wrong-held views of women of color and setting a new standard for American beauty. Dorothy was the second of two girls from the marriage of the outgoing actress Ruby Butler and her mild-mannered husband, Cyril Dandridge. Ruby's rebellion was outrageous, even in the relaxed moral climate of the 20s. When she was 4 months pregnant with Dorothy, she left Cyril and formed a new romantic relationship, this time with a woman. That began a pattern of mixed sexual signals that would distress and burden Dorothy throughout her lifetime. Ruby was a determined woman. She sang, danced, and performed wherever she could, hoping to open the doors of opportunity in Cleveland's Black Cafe Society. Hampered by too few outlets for her own talents, Ruby let her dreams expand to her tiny daughters. Those dreams started to find life before Dorothy was 4 years old. Ruby's intimate friend, Neva Williams, booked the sisters on a tour of Southern churches while Ruby stayed behind working on her career. They were billed as the Wonder Children. They sang, danced, and performed acrobatics. And during intermission, Dorothy and Vivian sold religious books to the audience. It was grueling work for children barely of kindergarten age. Left in Neva's less than kindly care, the little girls felt abandoned by their mother. It was just Dottie and Vivi holding on to each other, sometimes crying themselves to sleep at night. They continued to tour for several years. Then the Great Depression stamped out the touring career of the Wonder Children. Ruby was certain that they could do better in California, so the foursome headed for Hollywood. They found a tiny apartment, enrolled the girls in Lorette Butler's dancing school, and then finally in public school. Ruby threw herself ferociously into her search for stardom. There was no time to look closely at how her daughters were being raised by her companion. Years later, Dorothy told her husband, Harold Nicholas, that Neva Williams had abused her physically, sexually, and emotionally for more than a dozen years. That abuse was also described in Everything and Nothing, the Dorothy Dandridge story.
Why all the weeping and moaning? Why all the sighing and groaning? Something has happened that filled me with dread. Maybe the Moocher is dead.
By the time they were in their teens, the Wonder Children got a name change. Young classmate Etta Jones was added to the lineup, now called the Dandridge Sisters. Success came fast for the singers. They won first place in a talent contest sponsored by an LA radio station, were hired by a local circus, and traveled with the troupe to Hawaii. Within a year, they had toured the country, recorded with Jimmy Lunsford Band, and made their film debut. They danced with Bill Bojangles Robinson in the big broadcast of 1936. A year later, still unbilled, they sang and danced in the Marx Brothers classic, A Day at the Races. They were booked into New York's famed Cotton Club, and there, Dorothy met another teenager who would change her life.
We were co-starring with Cab Calloway in this new review at the Cotton Club. I think it was in 1938, I believe that's when it was. And there was Dorothy Dandridge with her sisters, Vivian and Etta. I had my eyes on Dorothy Dandridge, and so did my brother. But my brother and I, we never fight over women. And I could see that she was paying more attention to my brother than me, so I backed out. Oh, she was gorgeous. She was only, 15 years old at that time. Oh, well-developed and everything. What a beautiful girl she was. And my brother and I became good friends with her, and they were corresponding all the time.
Harold was a star, complete with limo and entourage, but he was only 16 himself. The teenagers courted for the next 4 years in a romantic, old-fashioned way. When he was on tour in Europe or South America, flowers and cards would arrive for Dorothy. She was thrilled at being pursued by the famous Harold Nicholas. She wrote fewer letters than he did. Her spotty education kept her from spelling well. It embarrassed her. Dorothy was told the chorus girls were standing in line to give Harold Nicholas what he wanted. But she couldn't. Neva was binding her breasts daily. Dorothy felt her emotions were also being strapped in, so she kept Harold at arm's length. Frightened of sex, she could do no more than kiss. Frustrated but in love, Harold wanted the intense young beauty so he was willing to wait.
You such a lazy bones.
Dorothy declared her independence in 1940 by physically beating Neva Williams, disbanding the Dandridge sisters, and looking for solo work. Despite her lifestyle choices, Ruby was still a role model for her daughters.
That's right.
She was determined to get work in Hollywood, and she did, as the maids and mammies typical of the times. And she got work for her daughter Vivian, too. She and Vivian were in Cabin in the Sky, and Ruby had a part in a film with an American cowboy hero.
Hi, Mr. Gabby. Hi, Mr. Roy.
You haven't seen Duke, have you, Devoria?
Well, what's the matter? What's happened to him?
If anybody else finds him before we do, the same thing's liable to happen to him that happened to Sam Talbot.
Same thing? You sound like that's a sure enough truth.
It is.
You've seen him. You know where he is.
No, I didn't say that. I promised that boy...
Devoria, if you don't tell us where he is, so help me.
Now, Mr. Gabby, don't get all fussed up. Can't go back on my word. But if the direction I'm going in and the direction I'm coming from sort of leads you to that old cave down by Rainbow Fall.
That's it.
Later, Ruby would get work in television, playing Oreo on Beulah and several episodes of Amos and Andy. Ruby and her daughter Vivian lent their voices to the then acceptable Coal Black and the Seven Dwarfs.
Oh, honey child, what story would you like to have Mammy tell you tonight?
I would like to hear about Stone White and the Seven Dwarfs, Mammy.
Well, once there was a mean old queen.
My hair's coal black, but my name's so white. I wash it all day, and I get the blues in the night.
Dorothy was determined she would never play those kinds of characters, like her mother and sister. Finding roles in Hollywood was hard. Actors who could pass for any other race were advised to do so. Dorothy said even the great black actor-writer Clarence Muse told Ruby that her daughter was too pretty and not black enough to play the roles available to her at that time.
It was a difficult time for African-American actors and actresses. And it's always been more difficult for women. The black woman usually had almost no roles offered to her except menial ones.
Jack, isn't it a beautiful night? I just love parties, don't you?
I beg your pardon?
Thank you kindly. Yes? Hello?
Praise the Lord, Mr. Room. Is you a hand or is you ain't?
Hi, Aunt Delphi. How come you here? The judge say you up there at that college learn to be a lawyer man.
Aunt Dilsey, I got stomach trouble.
Law help you, white child. What them Yankees been feeding you?
Sweet-faced young Dorothy often danced and sometimes sang her way through short films, then called soundies.
I'm going to buy a paper doll that I can call my own. A doll that other fellows cannot steal.
Every night I thank my stars that I was born their king. I know that you'll agree with me when I tell you what they did. They made me swing for my supper when I was a tot. They made me rock and roll, put it on red hot. Each night at the table, here's what Papa said. Get it and warm up me hidey-high, sling me a slice of bread.
Despite hating cigarette smoke, the aggressive advances from the male customers, and having to go in through the back door, Dorothy began working in nightclubs as a solo act, keeping herself on Hollywood's radar.
The natural outgrowth of that would normally be, all right, was she going to do film? And of course she wanted to.
This maiden is old. It is our law that she may be bought for wife. Two men want her. Baruda is rich. He had plenty of money, plenty of cattle.
She was incredible in front of the camera. She exuded the kind of sexuality that makes someone a star.
Singing his cow, cow, boogie in the strangest way. Come a tie, come a tie, yip the sky.
She wasn't a great dancer, but she could move. And that's when we asked Dale F. Zanuck, the president of 20th Century Fox, that we wanted her to do this movie with us and introduce this song, Chattanooga Choo Choo.
Oh, pardon me, boy.
Yes, yes.
Is that the Chattanooga Choo Choo?
That's the Chattanooga Choo Choo.
On track 29. 29.
So she got the contract. We went to the rehearsal hall, and everybody was there. Dorothy Dandridge was there. Glenn Miller and his orchestra were there. And Matt Garden started singing this Chattanooga Choo Choo. So I'm listening to this song, and to myself I said, what is the hell is that? What? And I turned to Glenn, was sitting right next to me, Glenn Miller. I said, Glenn, what do you think of this song? He said, it stinks. Oh. That was Glenn Miller's best-selling record, Chattanooga Choo Choo.
The teenagers had romanticized and idealized marriage, and they also saw it as a way to escape their smothering and mothering families. In 1941, they got married in a wedding that looked like a fairy tale, the place to be for all of Hollywood's black society. Dorothy went into the marriage a timid virgin, but they were both too young, too emotional, and far too inexperienced for married life. It would prove to be a disaster.
Dorothy Dandridge and Harold Nicholas were teenagers when they met. I believe she was 15, he was 16. Once somebody's on the road, they don't know about being at home. They don't know what a home is. I think that's what happened to Harold Nicholas. Dorothy Dandridge wanted the home. Harold Nicholas couldn't stay home. He didn't bring her that white picket fence that she so craved.
She couldn't keep up with him. He'd always go and play golf instead of being home with Dorothy. He never did treat her badly or slap her or anything like that. But it was so funny. He would come home after the golf thing. He would go and take a shower, have a little bite to eat. He'd get dressed, and he goes out to a nightclub with the boys. She was unhappy about that because she wanted to be real. Great marriage.
1 year into their marriage, their only child, Harolyn, was born severely brain damaged. Dorothy blamed herself, and that guilt fueled her actions and made her ever more determined to find security, safety, stardom.
I think that Dorothy Dandridge's biggest personal tragedy was, of course, the condition of her daughter. And that was the driving force of the rest of her life. Dorothy Dandridge needed money to keep her child in an expensive institution. Without that money, she would be in a state institution, and you can imagine what those were like in the late 1950s, early 1960s.
Dorothy and Harold stayed together until their child was about 4 years old. All those years, they had taken the child to dozens of doctors, tried different therapies, prayed. Finally, Dr. Ethel Harrington made it very clear there would be no miracle. The child would never speak, never know her parents. Harold went to work in Europe, and they quietly got a divorce a few years later. Meanwhile, Dorothy had to go back to what she called saloons, although they were some of the most prestigious nightclubs in the world.
Here I stand again, about to beat the band again.
On stage, she was the most dazzling and sensational performer around. Off stage, she was introverted and quiet. Dorothy and writer-arranger Phil Moore polished her nightclub skills, anchoring the act on her sophistication and silky smooth dance moves, and her appeal with white audiences. Hollywood's in-crowd saw her performing at the Gala Club, loved her, and raved to their friends. Soon, there were better engagements, including a highly visible appearance with Cuban bandleader Desi Arnaz at the Macambo. Later, she would headline at that lush Los Angeles club. Dorothy made her first TV appearance in 1951.
This young lady is making her initial appearance in television tonight on our Colgate Comedy Hour. And we'd like very much for you ladies and gentlemen to wish her well with a nice, wonderful reception. The lovely and charming Miss Dorothy Dandridge.
Won't you blow out the candle so there will be no scandal and no one will know you've been kissing me.
Other important television appearances would follow over the next several years. Ed Sullivan's Toast of the Town. Jackie Gleason's Cavalcade of Stars.
Ford Star Jubilee presents You're the Top. Starring in the great music of Cole Porter.
Oh, you do something to me that nobody else can do.
Her star was on the rise when America's reigning film beauties were Rita Hayworth, Ava Gardner, and Elizabeth Taylor. Dorothy was about to put a new spin on movie magnetism. She was electrifying and sexual in her first important screen role in Tarzan's Peril.
Once again, Tarzan's war cry rings through the African jungle, a daring challenge to the ominous rhythm of battle drums, beating a warning of danger as a ruthless jungle tribe, incited by international intrigue and duplicity, strikes terror and death upon peaceful natives who find themselves helpless and unprepared against an armed onslaught.
There was so much sizzle between Herkimer Melmindy and Lex Barker's Tarzan, one reviewer said Tarzan forgot all about Jane when Dorothy was on the screen. The press, Hollywood, and the fans seemed to focus on her sexiness. This annoyed Dorothy, but she was wise enough not to openly complain. She concentrated on finding roles that would allow her to be seen differently. She played a young wife in the film Harlem Globetrotters.
I guess I always felt in my heart that you needed to be taken down a peg. But now I don't like it. It hurts me, Bill.
I'm Dorothy Dandridge. I play the role of a teacher. This was my first day, and I wasn't sure how it was all going to work out.
Then as the demure school teacher in Bright Road, she starred opposite Harry Belafonte. Dorothy had a short romance with Belafonte. Then she fell in love with British actor Peter Lawford. The tenor of the times would not allow them to be open about their interracial romance, so it cooled. But they would remain devoted friends for her lifetime. As soon as her films were wrapped, Dorothy was off touring, by now in the world's most glamorous night spots. Along the way, she broke the color barriers at some of America's finer establishments. The Chase Hotel in St. Louis, the Last Frontier in Las Vegas, and eventually, the Pinnacle, the Empire Room of the Waldorf Astoria. While the audiences were crowding in to see this club sensation, Dorothy was often locked in her dressing room, sometimes throwing up or hyperventilating. As her fame grew, her nerves frayed. Hollywood was buzzing with the news that Otto Preminger was going to produce and direct a modern version of Bizet's opera, Carmen, with an all-black cast, and every black actress wanted to be Carmen Jones.
It was such a big deal when they decided to do Carmen Jones. And I guess that came about really because it was such a brilliant idea to do Carmen Jones on Broadway, and it succeeded so absolutely well. The success of that finally gave someone the idea in Hollywood that, hey, this would be one hell of a picture if we can transfer it from stage. Anyway, then the question was finding an actress.
When your lover decides to fly, there ain't no door that you can close. She just picks you a quick goodbye and flicks the salt from a tail and goes.
prior to Carmen Jones, she had often played softer roles. She wanted that role in Carmen Jones extraordinarily badly, enough to turn herself into a vixen, walk into Otto Preminger's office and say, I can do this part. Otto Preminger not only gave her the part, he gave her his heart and soul for about 3-4 years as well.
What's mine's yours, Joey. And that goes right down the line.
Dorothy won the part and threw herself into perfecting her role as Carmen. She listened to Preminger and gave him everything he demanded as he bullied and praised her, wringing from her the performance that would earn her the Oscar nomination. The entire weight of this film was on her small frame. There were times she would retreat into herself and was misunderstood because of it.
I always felt for Dorothy because I felt it was a very difficult position to be in. And then sometimes I felt that people on the set were not very kind to her because she didn't speak to them. They assumed that she was being stuck up for. And it was not that at all. Dorothy was wonderful. I looked at that film not long ago and I thought, she was really very good. She did a wonderful job.
You take us to Chicago. Show us a good time. What we got to do for you?
Don't ask him that now, honey. Let's get to Chicago first.
So you run out on me. Sure. We can give you a better time than I can. Fancy clothes. Swell company. The whole works. Husky Miller's latest woman.
I didn't first meet Dorothy on the movie set. We were friends. And I wasn't supposed to be in that picture. The fact is, I was in Korea, and Otto Preminger sent for me over there. They met me at the airport, brought me to the studio, and Otto Preminger, as I walked in, said, that's Husky Miller. I was the only lead character that didn't audition. We started shooting 2 days later.
Stand up and fight until you hear the bell. Stand toe to toe, trade blow for blow.
We did a fight scene. I staggered to my trailer dressing room. And I was so out of it, I went to the wrong dressing room. I went to Dorothy's dressing room. Her trailer was right next to mine. And I went in and just fell out on the floor. I didn't realize it was her dressing room. And she was not the beautiful Dorothy Dandridge as we know her exterior-wise. Her beauty that day came from within. She treated me like I was a little lost orphan. And she consoled me and made me feel better. And we both just stretched out there on the floor. And we must have talked for 3 hours.
My experience with her was such a kind of personal one, in terms of her not knowing me when I came to Carmen Jones. She knew who Harry was, and she knew then. But Brock Peters was an unknown quantity to her. And, I mean, and this is not necessarily a secret. It's apparently both in Preminger's book and in Goldwyn's book that she expressed some lack of ease with me.
In truth, Dorothy felt a lack of ease with just about everything, including her affair with Otto Preminger, begun during filming. Pulled in all directions, she began leaning more and more on tranquilizers. The buzz about Carmen should have boosted her spirits. It was great. Otto praised her, told her she could get an Oscar nomination. She held on to Otto's vision of her, gaining strength from it.
What I found most interesting about her was how she worked internally as a woman, how her mind worked, how no matter how many people thought she was beautiful, she didn't feel it unless the one she loved felt it or was giving her this kind of validation she needed, which is a universal thing.
The world was about to validate her talent and beauty. She appeared in glorious color on the November 1st, 1955 cover of Life magazine. The Life cover put her in the category of pioneer once more. Jackie Robinson had been on the cover of Life 5 years earlier. Now they were linked in the consciousness of an America poised on the brink of social and cultural changes. Carmen Jones premiered on October 28th to impressive reviews, capped by the Hollywood Reporter's headline, Dorothy Dandridge as Carmen. Wow. Dorothy pulled her nerves together and continued a whirlwind of activity, publicity events, social engagements, a grueling nightclub performance schedule. She was in Denver on February 12th when history happened. Dorothy heard her name announced in the nominations for the 1954 Academy Awards. She screamed and phoned her mother and sister Vivi. Harold Nicholas telephoned her. Peter Lawford sent her a telegram of congratulations. Dorothy couldn't have been happier. It was a wild, exciting time for Dorothy. Lush layouts appeared in Esquire, Look, and every black publication in America. Soon friends, family, and even Hollywood columnists were forecasting an Oscar win for Dorothy.
I saw all the movies, like the one with Grace Kelly and Judy Garland and the other actresses. I said, Dorothy is the best. She should win.
Dorothy and Otto went to the Cannes Film Festival. Excited crowds followed her, chanting her name, showering her with adoration. In France, she was treated like the film queen she had become. There was a special screening of Carmen Jones, and Otto was constantly at her side with praise, advice, devotion. His vision of Dorothy as the ultimate movie star was coming true. March 30th, 1955, when screen goddess Dorothy Dandridge stepped out of the limousine, with flash bulbs lighting up the sky, she was stepping onto brand new ground, the first black woman ever to walk the red carpet as an Oscar nominee for Best Actress. A shaky Dorothy Dandridge became the first black actress ever to present an Oscar at the annual ceremonies, a momentous occasion itself.
To present the Film Editing Award, we take you again to New York, and the only girl in the history to get me to go to the opera, Carmen Jones in person, Miss Dorothy Dandridge.
Thank you, Bob. If I seem a little nervous, this is as big a moment for me as it will be for the winner of this award. For film editing. In Hollywood, on the waterfront, Gene Melford.
After Dorothy did Carmen Jones and got the Academy Award nomination, and she thought she was going to win. Why she thought she was going to win when she was up against Judy Garland, I don't know, and Grace Kelly won in any event, but she thought she was going to win.
Dorothy did not win the Academy Award that windy March night, 1955, but she told her manager, Earl Mills, that it was really okay. There was time. She would win someday. Meanwhile, there was work to do.
After that, she thought that there were going to be a lot of opportunities for her. And in fact, 20th Century Fox had offered her a four-picture deal. But Otto Preminger convinced her not to take that deal. Now, whether he convinced her not to take that deal because he didn't think that Fox really had appropriate roles for her and was really going to develop her as a star, or whether he said don't take the deal because he wanted Dorothy Dandridge to be his creation, is up to speculation.
I think she was guided the wrong way, like Otto Preminger would tell her, don't do that. Now, if she had done it, I'm sure she would have done a good job in the King and I. It was for 20th Century Fox, the same company that did Carmen Jones. And Zanuck wanted her to do this film. But Preminger told her not to do it. He was a bad influence on her, wasn't he?
Otto wanted to run every aspect of her life. It was tearing Dorothy apart. Dorothy was one part compliant woman of the 50s and one part fighter who had been out there on the entertainment road for nearly 30 years. She listened to Otto. She fought with Otto. Suddenly, she was without her sister. After a fight, Vivian simply disappeared. They never saw each other again. Ruby had a new woman in her life and didn't want Dorothy around. Isolated and alone, Dorothy ran to her therapist, called it quits with Otto, and looked for work.
There was not a career waiting for Dorothy Dandridge. There wasn't an upcry in the land in the 1950s also for African-American talent in front of the cameras.
Oh, island in the sun, will to me by my father's hand.
And then came Island in the Sun, which had ridiculous interracial romances in which the parties couldn't touch. I mean, Dorothy Dandridge couldn't touch John Justin. Joan Fontaine couldn't touch Harry Belafonte, at least not on the screen.
And so all of that made it really difficult for black actors and actresses to exude a kind of sexuality that was authentic and non-threatening at the same time.
What was Dorothy Dandridge supposed to do? In other words, I don't know if the world's ready for Dorothy Dandridge, a sexy, vibrant woman to take hold of the screen.
Hollywood could not or would not deliver leading lady roles for Dorothy. She starred in two European films in quick succession, To Mango
about you that I like. Nothing. No. I'm telling the truth to a white man. For the first time in my life.
And the decks ran red.
A far cry from the luxury liner he was leaving. James Mason portrays the ambitious first officer who at long last gets to captain his own ship. But at what a price. A reckless woman among violent men. Dorothy Dandridge portrays the exotic Mahia.
I suggest that while you're on this ship, you wear something a little less revealing.
Both were low budget, but she played opposite well-respected white actors, love scenes and all. The decks ran red included Filmland's first interracial kiss between Dorothy and Stuart Whitman. By this time, she had also met the man who would become her second husband, Jack Dennison.
She told me some things like, I guess I can say them now, how she had lived somewhat of a lonely life. I said something like, why would you live a lonely life? Everybody would like to take you out to dinner or have a date with you. She said, have you ever thought of taking me out to dinner or having a date with me? And I said, yes. I said, but truthfully, I don't like people to say no to me, so I would never approach you. And she says, and you're one of the most aggressive people that I have ever met in everything, business and everything else. Now, if you think like that, think what the other people think. And she says, that's what happens. People won't ask me to go places because they think 50 other people have already asked me. And it ends up, nobody's asked me. And she said, so I spend a lot of time to myself.
By 1958, Dorothy had been working almost consistently for 30 years. Time was taking its toll on her, physically and emotionally. She often mixed alcohol with her prescription drugs to keep herself going. Her strength of spirit led her to keep on knocking on stardom's door. She was about to get a second chance at a film with an all-black cast.
The second feature was Porgy and Bess. And they were 8 years apart. Film opportunities didn't come swiftly in that period for anybody, really. She wanted to strengthen her performing skills because she realized that if she was going to get the opportunities, then she needed to be prepared. She wanted to go. As a matter of fact, by the time we were halfway through Porgy, she was talking about coming to New York and working. I didn't see her a lot in the years between Carmen Jones and Porgy. And when we began to work on Porgy, she seemed to me to be in relatively the same place. There were things that happened during the filming of Porgy that I saw as her struggle and her ability to affect changes that she needed to.
There was much struggle over Porgy and Bess. The black world on the edge of the civil rights movement hated the stereotypical characterizations.
Oh, Lord, I'm on my way.
Sidney Poitier didn't want to be in it, but was pressured into it.
Life is just begun.
The crowning blow came when Otto Preminger became its last-minute director. For this film, his bullying didn't come from love, and it left Dorothy crying and shaken on and off the set. Dorothy seemed to have faulty radar when it came to romance. Perhaps it was her childhood, perhaps her isolation, perhaps her unrealized desires. Bewitched by gambler Jack Dennison, despite all her friends' warnings, she married him. Then, in the next 2 years, the people handling her finances swindled her out of $150,000. Her new husband humiliated and often beat her. Finally, she divorced Dennison. The date was November 9th, 1962. Dorothy Dandridge was 40 years old. More tragedy followed. The IRS chased her. The bills piled up, and Dorothy had to file for bankruptcy. It was a devastating public disgrace. She had to earn money, so back to the saloons. But the reviewers were unkind. Dorothy had no money to keep paying Helen Calhoun, the woman who cared for her daughter, Harolyn, for 10 years. When the check stopped, Calhoun sent the helpless girl home from Chicago by train, alone. Placing Harolyn in an institution had always been Dorothy's greatest fear. Shortly after she had her baby committed, Dorothy had to be hospitalized for depression. Earl Mills, Dorothy's devoted former manager, came back after she divorced Dennison. Earl had always been eager to do anything Dorothy wanted. He vowed to help her regain her health and find work. Soon, Earl had dates for her in Mexico, Puerto Rico, and Tokyo, with the promise of more to come. So, she started back at the gym to get into shape for the dates. There she fell and hurt her ankle. Dorothy didn't take care of her ankle. Instead, she went with Earl to negotiate a film project in Mexico. The trip was so successful, a deal was struck for two films. On September 8th, back in Los Angeles, Earl was to take Dorothy to have a cast put on the ankle. He rang the bell. She didn't answer. So he broke the chain on the door, only to find Dorothy dead on the bathroom floor. There has always been speculation. Was it suicide?
They always say that she committed suicide. But no. Why could she commit suicide? Because she had four films that she was going to do. So why should she kill herself? Because this is what she always wanted to do, is to make movies. So when they ask me or say, did she really kill herself? I say, no, I don't think so. Because she loved life and she wanted to make movies. And she had four contracts to make these movies. No, no, no way.
Whether Dorothy Dandridge took an overdose of pills to deliberately kill herself. She was killed by the world around her. This is someone who had once got an Academy Award nomination, and by the early 1960s could barely get $1.50 for singing in a cabaret, who had $2.50 in her bank account at the end of her life.
Dorothy left clear instructions on how she was to be buried. She chose Angela's funeral home, not far from where she lived with Harold, to handle the arrangements. She didn't want anybody to see her body, so the casket was sealed. Dorothy was cremated. The service held at the little chapel of flowers in Glendale's Forest Lawn Cemetery. Pallbearer Peter Lawford cried throughout the entire ceremony, unable to speak. Harold sat quietly, kissed a white rose, and laid it very softly on her casket. Jack Dennison did not attend. Vivian Dandridge did not attend. Otto Preminger did not attend. Cyril Dandridge flew to Los Angeles for the funeral, but Ruby had given him the wrong date. A last cruelty to the man who had his daughters taken from him. Dorothy Dandridge was laid to rest, but her restless spirit seemed to whisper to the actresses born the decade she died. They fell in love with her image on late night television. They read all the magazine articles about her. Then a series of books appeared. Her purported autobiography, Donald Bogle's biography, and Earl Mills' book, which would become the basis for the film, Introducing Dorothy Dandridge. Whitney Houston sponsored a film retrospective in New York's Film Forum. She was everywhere.
The myth of Dorothy Dandridge comes from the 1980s, and it comes from a hunger from African-American artists to find someone who came before them and got a raw deal or could have gone further. I don't think that there is one African-American actress with even a modicum of a name who did not somehow want to be Dorothy Dandridge on the screen. And we're talking here everyone from Whitney Houston to Jada Pinkett Smith to Vanessa Williams, Angela Bassett, Janet Jackson. They all wanted to be Dorothy Dandridge, and why not? It was a great, juicy part.
Hollywood had rediscovered Dorothy Dandridge in a mainstream way.
It's one of those true Hollywood stories. I went to a party, and everybody's standing by the pool doing the little, you know, chit-chat, chit-chat. And these two long, tall, lanky girls came over to me, who would turn out to be Carrie and Jody Hamilton, Carol Burnett's daughters, who were very interested in producing and directing films. It was an incredible film. It was a short film about three women the hour before their death. And they said to me, they said, would you like to play Dorothy Dandridge? I said, more than anything else in the world.
I remember Debbie Allen said to me, I want you to tell me about Dorothy Dandridge, because I'm planning to do Dorothy Dandridge. and Jasmine Guy, she said, Leon, I want you to tell me about Dorothy Dandridge. So many ladies wanted to do Dorothy Dandridge, but Halle Berry was the perfect one to do her, and she did a great job. She got the Golden Globe Award, didn't she, for that role. She got the SAG role and also the Emmy for that role.
Halle Berry worked 7 long years to bring Dorothy Dandridge to the screen. I had the pleasure of portraying Harold Nicholas in that film. It was a wonderful experience, reliving the power of that relationship.
This is a story that every studio in Hollywood, every other cable network said no to. And I just wouldn't give up. I thought that Dorothy deserved recognition. She deserves a place like Marilyn Monroe in not only Black history, but in American history. And tonight, she gets that. You know, this award is just as much for her as it is for me. And she so deserving. And tonight, she won big time. And that feels good to have been the vessel that allowed her to be able to do that.
Yay!
Dorothy Dandridge will never be forgotten. Breathtakingly beautiful, enormously talented, and determined. This dream goddess became a film legend and a pioneer, forever transforming the worldview of black women. Dorothy Dandridge, an American beauty. I'm Oba Babatunde. Thank you for joining us.